Almighty God, who, in thy infinite wisdom and providential goodness, has appointed the offices of rulers and councils for the welfare of society and the just government of man, we beseech thee to behold with thy abundant favor us thy servants, whom thou hast been pleased to call to the performance of such important trust in the Commonwealth of Dominica. Let thy blessing descend upon us here in this parliament assembled, and grant that we may, as in thy presence, treat and consider all matters that shall come under our deliberation in so just and faithful a manner as to promote thy honor and glory, and to advance the good of those whose interests thou hast committed to our charge, all which we ask in the name and for the sake of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Good morning. It was my full intention to make a statement yesterday after the lunch period about the leader of the opposition's behavior, but I needed to have the transcript relating to the events of the 27th or 26th of June, as it were, and so I shall do so now. I actually want to read from the transcript that I obtained, so that a context can be ascertained and clearly seen about certain things. That was during the debate on the Money Laundering Prevention Act, the amendment thereto. The Honorable Member for Roseau North Constituency, Mr. Danny Lugay, said, "Thank you, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, in Minister Blackmore's brief introduction to the bill before the House, an act to amend the Money Laundering and Prevention Act, number 8 of 2011, Minister Blackmore, well, he referred to the parent legislation and he gave a description of money laundering and he used the words to define it. Conceal or disguise, take out of Dominica, proceeds and proceeds of crime. So, Madam Speaker, I, as the parliamentary representative for Roseau North, will support any legislation which prevents companies, lawyers, and well-placed individuals from hiding proceeds of crime as referred to in the Panama Papers, and we vote in favor of this amendment if the individual named as director in the British Inland Revenue reports are held to account for the hundreds of million dollars in that account." Madam Speaker, Speaker interjects, "Do you understand what the bill is about?" Member, "Yes, I understand fully, Madam Speaker." Speaker, "Well, can you demonstrate that through your contribution?" Member, "May I continue, Madam Speaker? I understand what I am debating about." Speaker, "I am asking you please to confine your contribution to the debate to matters pertaining to the little bit of legislation that is there, so that you tell me about what it is in this piece of amendment you may refer to as a parent act, but keep to it as far as possible." Member, "Thank you, Madam Speaker. I am saying I will work diligently with Minister Blackmore to ensure that money launderers outside and inside of this house are held to account and punished." Speaker, "Now let me explain something to you. I took pains this morning to explain to you about imputing improper motive. You just said money laundering to persons inside of this house." Member, "Anywhere they are, I did not refer to anybody in particular." I'll just read again what he said. Money launderers outside and inside of this house. Honorable member for Roseau North constituency continued, every person who is guilty of money laundering, speaker, no, you cannot. You are imputing improper motive. Why don't you understand? This is vastly different from somebody calling a company's name or whatever. We do not know where that company even is. Can't you understand the difference? I am sure if I told that to a 10-year-old, they would understand, and I hope that you do too. Member, your comprehension and others doesn't seem to be fair. Speaker, well, you see, guess what? Guess whose own counts in here? Member, you know I love you, but I hate the demon in you. I love you, but I hate the demon in you. Speaker, take your seat. The demons in me are telling you to take your seat. That's it. You apologize to the chair. You don't say that. No, 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 no. Well, then you are even repeating it. You apologize to the chair, or I'm going to ask you to leave. Take your seat until you apologize. I apologize to the chair. I take it back. I take it back, Madam Speaker. Speaker, and you know something? It's just sad that there is always a rider when you want to say your things. I remember when what was said at one time, because it was all in the air, you said then, and there was a rider. I do hope you understand what a rider is. Member, may I continue, Madam Speaker? No, no, no. That's it, that's it. Member, that's it, yes. You can't be saying I have demons on me and all that and inspect, interjection by the member. But you insulted the members of the House. You insulted members in the House, mainly those on the other side. You did. Madam Speaker, you cannot prevent me from making my contribution. I apologize, I take it back. Why are you preventing me? Speaker, well, you need to apologize twice or three times because I heard you say it more than once. Honorable member for the Roseau North constituency, Danny Lugo. No, no, I apologize. I apologize 20 times. Speaker, let me tell you something. Honorable member says again, what is it that is hurting you so much? What is it that's hurting you all so much? Why are you all afraid of Danny Lugo? There's no need to be afraid. Truth, I'm talking. We're dealing with money and money laundering. Speaker, order, please. By this time, there's a whole lot of noise going on. Member, I apologize to you. Speaker, you come to the House to do your constituency business. As I said to you this morning, you do, but you have to operate within rules. Member, that's what I'm doing, Madam Speaker, but you are obstructing me. Speaker, I have determined that you are not doing that. And unfortunately for me, and for, I don't know, other speakers, this is a duty that I have. We sit here and we try to make members understand when they go afoul of the rules. And I tell them, but for a member to say, you like me, but you don't like the demons in me, just like you said, if you weren't a Christian, you wouldn't do this and that. You always say your things and then you put a rider. Member, I take it back, I take it back, I take it back. 20 times. Speaker, you see, and you do things and just wish them away. That can't work. You can't do this. It is not permissible. You have to deal with the matter. Louder sides, cross talks go on. Speaker, order please, everybody. You have to learn to debate within the rules. Unfortunately, when we had the session where people came from overseas to teach the members the rules of the House, members absented themselves and lost the opportunity to understand. This is not something that I am saying. There are rules, these are the rules, and unfortunately for the member who just said to me a while ago that my interpretation is different from his, and I had to point out to the member, my interpretation is what carries. Member, we know that, all powerful, we know that. Speaker, well, that's the way it is. Member, we know that, we know that. Speaker, that's the way it is, unfortunately for me. It is a burden I have to carry, you understand? And so I will have people, because of this burden which I carry, come into the house and tell me they like me, but they do not like demons in me. I do not know when they put demons in me because I do not recall any getting there. And if that's what you wish for me, apologizing doesn't take it away, because the whole world heard you. And so I consider your apology a fallacy and a fiction, in other words, insincere. But you carry on. But I'm watching and stop here, but there's more. Now, if after that exchange, at which the member was present, this exchange which I just read to the House, all you, the member for Marigot, understood from it was that it was okay, and I was happy to have been called a demon, to have been told I have demons in me. It is not I who called myself demons, and it is not okay to continue this insult to my face. And if you think otherwise, then you seriously need to review your comprehension of that situation. In any event, your insult came after you had been extremely rude to the chair when you asked me whether I was taking part in the debate simply because I was doing what I am as speaker supposed to do, and I am referring you again to Standing Order 86.1 and 2 and Standing Order 49. It is my duty to keep order in the House. It therefore bears repeating again that there is a difference between being behind a console in a studio and being a member of parliament here in this chamber. Further, the authority and ruling of the chair must be adhered to at all times. I hope, member for Marigot, leader of the opposition, you are processing by now how rude and out of order and wrong you were. In spite of the serious lapse of yesterday, in spite of your unprincipled behavior, in spite of your lack of order and common decency, I gave you all the time in the world to reflect and do the honorable thing. You had sufficient time to make your contribution after you apologized. You had your full 45 minutes. You chose not to apologize. And I must mention also, I gave all members of the opposition the opportunity to speak. And that is to say, I did not deny any member of the opposition the privilege and opportunity to speak on the motion. The member for Marigot, leader of the opposition, I want to make it clear, therefore, that my ruling regarding your apologizing to the chair before taking part in debate continues. You will not be allowed to speak on any matter coming before the House for the rest of this session unless you apologize, and I so rule. Debate continues.
Thank you very much, Madam Speaker, and I really appreciate hearing.
I would appreciate the member. I am going to take a serious view of such lapses. I will not sit here and be insulted by the members anymore. Consider what I just said there, part one of the Riot Act.
What are you referring to, Madam Speaker? I just start speaking. Why are you getting hot and bothered? So yes, Madam Speaker, I was saying that I appreciate hearing the account of the last sitting of Parliament. It was really refreshing. Now, Madam Speaker, on the matter of the supplementary appropriations for financial year July 2015 to June 2016. I take the view, Madam Speaker, that there seems to be an ATM or automatic teller machine placed or fixed in the office of Prime Minister Skerrington, Minister of Finance.
Speaker,
why do I
Madam
say
Speaker,
you, you?
Madam Speaker, please. Madam Speaker, I am taking strong objection to the statement, and I am seeking for the member for Roseau North to withdraw this point and his attempt to insinuation and his attempt to impute improper motives, Madam Speaker. There is absolutely no ATM machine owned by the government of Dominica here or anywhere else in the world.
I don't understand.
And I will not accept members coming here from attempting again and seeking to impute improper motives on members. The member must withdraw the statement because it is factually wrong, it is untrue, and there is no ATM machine.
The Honorable Prime Minister, I would like to be the one to do this, please. The member, you
Thank
are
you very much,
you
Madam Speaker.
Have just created a serious breach of improper motive once again. And I call on you to withdraw that statement and apologize.
Madam Speaker, I said it seems to me.
It doesn't matter
it seems
whether
to
you
me.
Seem to. You can't say that.
Okay.
Why
Madam
don't
Speaker,
you get it?
Will you give me an opportunity to explain?
No, no, you cannot explain wrong. You can, you just move on, please.
Okay, I'm moving on.
No.
Apologize to who? Withdrawn, Madam Speaker.
I'm only asking for, subject to your ruling, Madam Speaker. Subject to your ruling, I'm only asking for withdrawal.
This has to stop.
But he must also apologize to the Minister of Finance.
Apologize for what?
You know,
Speaker, do you want me
two
to apologize?
Members cannot be standing at the same time.
Madam Speaker.
And what, are you standing on a point of order?
On a point of order, Madam Speaker.
What's your point of order?
Madam Speaker, yesterday, the Honorable Minister of Education, when he mentioned the different
Your
ISAPs,
point of order
I
is to
him,
say
Madam
what?
Speaker, I asked him to apologize. He didn't. He sat down. He didn't apologize.
Minute.
Today, the Prime Minister said, up.
Can you take your seat, please? You are... No, no, no. Quilly, please. Just one moment, please. Just one moment, please. Both sides. Both sides. The member, when you rise on a point of order, you say what breach of point of order there is. This is the procedure. You cannot rise and just go into a diatribe. You say, Madam Speaker, I rise on a point of order. The member is in breach of standing order, so and so and so. And then you continue to say the actual breach when it occurred. You don't just ride and there has to be some order in the house. This is nonsense now. I have people, will you listen to me, please? Don't you, wait a minute. I don't understand this level of lack of something. Will you be silent? Is that an impossibility for you? Why won't you members learn to do things correctly? What is the difficulty in that? As you pointed out just now, this is a Westminster model system, and there are rules to be observed. Members just think that they can do whatever they like because they claim the people voted for them. The member, you are the one who is bringing inconsistency to the whole thing. Making wild accusations. You stand and you do the thing properly. I stopped the Prime Minister, didn't you see that? Members, please. I insist there be decorum in this house, and I'm going to take a very, very hard line on it from now on. Things have gotten too bad. You rose to say something? You rise on a point of order?
To refer to the rules.
Yes. Okay. This is terrible.
Yes. Madam Speaker, if I'm perhaps too tall. Yes. No, that's fine. Madam Speaker, if I may, I just wanted to refer to Standing Order 52A. Any member who has used objectionable or unparliamentary expressions and on being called to order has refused to withdraw such words or expressions or to explain them and has not offered an apology for the use thereof to the satisfaction of the House and has not offered an apology for the use thereof to the satisfaction of the House may be proceeded against and dealt with as though he had committed an offence under paragraph 2B of this order. The member, Madam Speaker, is refusing to apologize. This rule requires him to apologize or certain steps can be taken.
Madam Speaker, with all of the raising of objections and standing order objections and so on, I just wanted to be clear what your ruling was this morning, because yesterday we had an incident and the matter before us concluded and we moved on with the sitting of the parliament. Moving on with the sitting of the parliament involved me as the member for the Margaret constituency posing a question to the minister responsible for foreign affairs. And so I did in fact participate in the affairs of the parliament subsequent to the incident that caused some concern yesterday. You're now returning to that incident this morning and ruling that what? I will not be participating any further in the affairs of this parliament?
I'm not going to read all that I said. Simply to read the last part to say, I want to make it clear, therefore, that my ruling regarding to your taking part in debate continues. Taking part in debate. I will repeat again. I wish to make it clear that my ruling regarding your taking part in debate continues. And that, dear member, is the end of the matter. Until you apologize, I will not hear you. I am asking the member to take his seat, please. Sergeant at arms. Sergeant at arms, can you escort the member out,
the
please?
It's not necessary for any escort of Sergeant at arms. I am leaving the house.
This is the parliament where the speaker presides. This is just intolerable. Absolutely intolerable. a member who treats this house like a studio, that he behaves as if he's before a console. It's absolutely reprehensible, and I, as the person presiding, cannot allow members to abuse the house in such a manner. It is obvious to me that the member is much more comfortable before console, and I guess he's on his way there. Can we continue with business of the house? And the member, please understand, you were told that you have to withdraw, and as was pointed out to you, where there is this case, you may want to wish to take time out and read the rule for yourself. Apologize, as is required by the rules.
Madam Speaker, I just had was one sentence into my presentation, so I'm not even given a chance to explain my one sentence. Can you imagine that? But anyway, I withdraw. Some years ago,
you were required to withdraw and apologize. You want me to read the rule again, or you wish to read it yourself?
It said with explanation. She just read it. She just read the rule.
And you don't address members as she. Can't you be...
Madam Speaker, I apologize.
Good. Yeah. And you may continue, please.
I will deal with you on the radio, don't worry. Some years ago, Madam Speaker...
And a member, another thing, you don't threaten members in here. I will deal with you on the radio.
I'm not a threat.
Member, please, what can I do to make you...
The time is 10 past 10, Madam Speaker, do not take from my time.
The member.
10 past 10. What the house really scared about, Nadani Luge? What is this?
Excuse me.
About?
You were paid a compliment in case you did not realize it. No, wait a minute. I am the member. I am trying to, I don't know how else to do it, to put before you that there is a certain decorum required of members. There is a certain terminology that members must use. There is a certain procedure to be followed. And member, please, can you conduct yourself accordingly? Please, because young people are watching you and they are seeing how you are behaving. They form their own opinion. And will as one sentence can be as potent as one word or as a chapter. It's not the length, is the content. And if you would only listen, you would learn. Please do not follow those who are too arrogant to listen. You do not learn while you are speaking. One cannot learn when one is speaking. Please, I am asking you, conduct yourself as is required of you, so you can represent your constituents adequately. Please continue without any lack of decorum, okay? I will actually, in a fit of generosity, give you a time from now.
Madam Speaker,
are you happy with that?
Madam Speaker, some years ago, without the prior permission of Parliament, $500,000 was handed to Crazy Coconuts. That enterprise has since closed down, and I wonder how much of that loan was repaid. Today, under Head D31, we have a similar arrangement loan to a large business enterprise deemed too large or too massive to fail. Madam Speaker, you have DAPEX, an industry which employed in its heyday 5,000 people, 5,000 farmers, and about 400 workers. On 17 September 2012, Chairman of DAPEX wrote to the Honorable Prime Minister, the main item, destabilization of DAPEX capital assets to the extent that the company is on the verge of having no capital assets. And then point number two, long extended delay in refunding subsidy payments incurred by DAPEX, and the amount was $453,000. That's letter number one in the dossier of effort by DAPEX to get help from the government, just like it is giving help. I want to know what is the policy of government in extending help to companies. Here you have the banana industry, bigger than every other company, begging for a refund of $453,000, and we can't get that money. Letter dated January 11, 2016, to Mr. Harold Gies. Settlement of outstanding payments due to DAPEX by government. As you will appreciate, our proposal was, in our opinion, the better option, being a non-cash settlement. Here it is again, DAPEX is reaching out to the government, telling them, okay, you don't want to give us cash, you have fertilizer on your hands, please give us fertilizer. No response. September 10th, 2015, a letter to Mr. Harold Gies from now Chairman Grayson Steadman. The Dominica Banana Producers Limited, now the Dominica Agricultural Producers Limited, in July 12, 2012, enter into a sales and purchase agreement with government for the acquisition of three properties which formerly belonged to the Dominica Banana Marketing Corporation. An amount of $142,000 was paid towards the legal fees for acquiring these properties. That money from government was not refunded. June 10th, 2014, a letter to Honorable Matthew Walter from Mr. Grayson Steadman, again reaching out on a number of issues, asking to meet with the minister to sit down with him. Letter number five in the dossier, this time Honorable Johnson Drygo, and that letter was from Mr. Grayson Steadman, asking for a meeting. The purpose of that meeting was to brief you on the important issues which were discussed with your predecessor. So there's several letters requesting meetings, and not for heaven's sakes we can meet with the minister. August 11th, 2014, to Mr. Harold Gies from Mr. Grayson Steadman, fertilizer subsidy reimbursement. DAPEX has had several fertilizer subsidy programs with the government through the Ministry of Agriculture and have received payments in the past. The records show that we have written several letters and held discussions before on this matter. This request is for the final payment under the program. So on August 11, 2016, there was still an amount of 51,000 owed, and you know, that amount. December 4th, 2015, settlements of outstanding amounts due to DAPEX by government. It is our understanding that the government is expected a large shipment of about 30,000 bags of compound physical fertilizer and may have already received a large quantity of that shipment. DAPEX is therefore requesting that the government settle the amount of $230,161 due to DAPEX with a quantity of fertilizer. All of these efforts in a bid for assistance from a farmer's company, a company that touches the lives of people all over Dominica. The courtesy was extended to WeChurch and we supported it. WeChurch is too big to fail. However, it doesn't seem that the banana industry, not just the Apex, you know, featured also on the verge of collapsing. There's a big boast that plantlets were received. The technical people are now saying, let us cut back everything because the oil and chemicals that's needed, they sit in the pot on a warehouse, also fertilizers, cannot get to the farmer. And the fuel that's given out is given out by ministers of government to party supporters.
These are the things that you...
Speaker, I must rise on a point of order, Madam
Speaker. Point of order, yes.
I believe member is imputing improper motives to members of the House in breach of the standing orders. And I don't think that should be allowed to register into the records of the House.
The member...
Withdrawn.
Once again, you
withdrawn.
Have to withdraw and apologize. You cannot
withdrawn.
Impute... You can't... The rules say so. Is it that you don't understand how imputing improper motive works?
Madam Speaker, I've never heard a member on the other side apologize for nothing, unlike me. I've been apologizing from day one
wrong.
In this parliament.
That is
I've never heard.
Wrong.
I've heard withdrawn. I've never had an apology.
No.
So what is this about? Trying to intimidate?
Member.
What is that all about?
You know, I don't understand. This is not a war bond. Aleppo have enough war. You don't want that in Dominica too? Just listen and try to, you know, be rise high. What is it this lady says? If you think they're going low, go high.
Yeah, I'll rise high like that member there. This one.
Yes. Great. Now, can you continue without casting improper motives all over the place, please?
Okay, so the remainder, like I said, many meetings have been held with you, the Minister of Agriculture, relating to this matter. And on every occasion...
Are you reading? You
yes, I'm quoting.
Okay. Well, you must say
To show that several meetings were held with attempts made to meet with the minister. So I was just quoting the second paragraph. Many meetings were held with you and the Minister of Agriculture relating to this matter. And on every occasion, the commitment was made to regularize the sale of these properties to DAPEX. The last was on 28th March 2011 and with the Minister of Agriculture. 28th November 2012, Mr. Samuel Carrett, outstanding amount. We acknowledge payment for the sum of $132,400.
Excuse me, I don't even know what to do. We have a situation. I'm going to suspend the House for 10 minutes, please. Okay? Sergeant at Arms, I'll just go out. Okay? I think the members need to be apprised of what has happened. I don't want to say it on the mic. House resumes. Can I see the clock, please? Just to get the time. What time is suspended? Eh? 11. 25. So 10 minutes, okay. Okay, the member, you can continue. Bear in mind what I said, please. Let's try to do this thing with decorum, remembering that we are in the House of Assembly and so on. And you've gone 10 minutes already. You have a further 20 minutes, keeping within the rules while you make your contribution.
So, Madam Speaker, I asked the question earlier on what is government's policy on giving assistance to the private sector. When companies are too big to fail, it seems that that's one of the criteria to me. And here you have DAPEX, one of the largest industries on Ireland, now grounded to the floor, where we reach a situation, we have zero exports to the UK and under the watch of the Dominica Labour Party. On December 5th, I'm just giving further evidence of the effort made by DAPEX to reach out to government for assistance. And even in the case where government was owing close to the 500,000, which is the same amount that was given to Whitchurch, that we couldn't get that money. So the company had a problem of importing inputs to even survive. So this letter, December 5th, 2013, says, following the meeting of October 21, 2013, and that letter is to Honorable Matthew Walter. You agreed for a meeting with yourself on Friday, October 25th. On reporting for the meeting, I was informed by your secretary that you had been called to an urgent meeting and that the meeting was rescheduled for 2 p.m., to which we accepted. On reporting for the meeting at 2 p.m., your secretary again informed me you were invited to lunch. We asked for a reschedule of the meeting to the following Friday at 10 a.m. Your secretary subsequently informed that you confirm this meeting time and date to be acceptable. However, on reporting for this meeting, there was no show by yourself and there was no indication by you that the meeting was postponed, cancelled, or ever on. So here it is, a major industry, just like Dominica Coconut Products, employing 300 people, bringing in excess of $100 million into the country. The company failed. They had problems, whatever the challenges were. Promises were made by this sitting Prime Minister, the Honorable Roosevelt Skerritt, Minister of Finance. To date, nothing has been done. So what it seems to me, there's a picking and choosing of companies that can be given assistance, and others, it seems to me that there's a deliberate effort to ensure that these companies...
Member, you must choose your words more carefully. You borderlined by saying picking and choosing. You've got to understand, you have to phrase your contribution in such a way that you don't infringe your rules.
What rule have I infringed, Madam Speaker?
You're borderline on imputing improper motive.
Is borderline.
The member, take it from me. You don't seem to know what imputing improper motive is. You haven't grasped the full import of the word, and therefore rely on me to tell you when you're drifting into that arena.
Here goes your further insults. Here goes your further
Please take your seat. That's it. Take your seat. If your member cannot understand that I'm trying to guide you, you call it an insult. Take your seat. I'm not able to assist you.
So I'm not.
That's it. You can't tell me I'm insulting you when I'm trying to guide you. You just seem to have an inability to select your words carefully.
Madam Speaker, you're going to prevent
me. I am telling you, yes.
What are you preventing me from?
Yes, because you just. Well, you need to apologize
again. So what do you want to see? The whole area here, Claire.
No. I want to see members behave decently. That's what I want to see.
But why are you preventing me from making my contribution? What have I done? What have I done? Why are you preventing me? No, but I mean, there's no reason for disallowing me.
time you bother it. Every time one of your opposition members are bothering on the fridge and on your own.
I'm count. You just said I insulted you. You cannot, you cannot say that to the chair, and you need to apologize to the chair. Get it straight. I'm not taking this nonsense anymore. You've got to respect the chair. And if you won't respect the chair will not hear you. When you apologize.
From the dossier of efforts by DAPEX, the largest company on island, grounded to zero by the sitting government.
You letter, excuse me, just one
letter
moment.
Letter number 11.
Just one moment. There is also a rule about being tedious and repetitive. I am telling you about a rule. I never said you repeat it. You repeated. I'm reminding you of the rule. Don't you understand the difference between a reminder and a warning? I can't be teaching comprehension as well, you know.
I haven't repeated anything. Letter number 11, September 24, 2011, to Honorable Matthew Walters, from then Chairman Luke Privo. And also copied to Mr. Samuel Carrett. Topic, reimbursement of fertilizer subsidy. So another, going back to 2011, that's how long that DAPEX have been trying to get help from this government. Can't get any help. February 12, 2016, to Mr. Harold Gies, from current chairman, Mr. Grayson Stedman. I refer to the attached letter dated December 4th, 2015. For ease of reference, and to date, we have not received an acknowledgement and or a response to our request for an appointment to meet with the minister. This is notwithstanding my several calls to your office and also to the minister's secretary for an appointment. Letter number 13 of the efforts by DAPEX to get appointments and to meet with the minister. That's to Mr. Harold Gies, March 15, 2016. Here it is that DAPEX is listing the number of problems that they have. Listed here under are a few of the major contributing factors of DAPEX issues. One, lack of working capital for restocking inventory supplies. Two, unavailability of fresh produce and particularly bananas for export. Three, the passage of Tropical Storm Erica has negatively impacted on the availability of produce for export. Four, the free issue of fertilizer has reduced sales. Five, the tardiness of payments for fertilizer subsidy. Six, loss of the USA market for Dashing due to the unavailability of air freight as a result to damage to the airport. So, Madam Speaker, 14 instances, and imagine that's not the whole file, you know, of effort by DAPEX to get assistance for major industry on the verge of collapse with no assistance, and in many cases where we ask for a refund for monies placed to for purchase of properties, that refund wasn't done. So you could tell that atmosphere of hostility towards DAPEX, whereas we have other companies benefiting like Crazy Coconuts. Madam Speaker, on the expenditure head, D34, $767,500 was allocated to the housing and sanitation for the Sufia constituency. What I would really like to know, because we are well aware that there were abuses there, that several trucks were seen headed to the Point Michel and Soufriere constituency ahead of the by-election. We see that among 767,500. We also are aware that close to or above $3 million was used for the ahead of the by-election. Now, even in the supplementary appropriations, there are several amongst that no details are given. I would like to sound a warning to the PSEs and the financial secretary that they must give this house details of how monies are spent. They had tax money collected from the taxpayers of Dominica. How these monies are spent. We cannot be hiding how monies are spent. Madam Speaker, you have on the expenditure head.
Before you go on, remember, it is your choice of words that get you. You cannot accuse public servants of hiding. You can't do that. You simply cannot do it, and I will not permit you to do it. You have got to, I don't know, get another dictionary or something, but your choice of words are not parliamentary. I will not accept them. You sit here, you stand here, you cannot accuse public servants of hiding. You cannot do it. It's not permissible. You need to apologize to them again and withdraw that. And if that's how the tenure of your contribution is going to be, so be it.
Okay, so instead of using the word hiding, I say withholding information from the
parliament. You can't do that either.
But, Madam Speaker, information is
withheld. The word that you need is omitted.
Withholding information?
They're not withholding information.
What happens? You want to make my presentation for me?
I know.
What rule have I broken?
I don't know.
That information is witchcraft. Witchcraft in this house. It's only witchcraft that can seek to manipulate people that way. But of course, that's what it is. Witchcraft. Look for the definition of witchcraft. That's what's going on. And Danny Lugia will not be manipulated to that extent.
Madam Speaker, if I may.
Will you please take your seat? Let me hear what the member is saying. He rose on a point of order, I take it?
Yes, Madam Speaker, on a point of order, Madam Speaker.
It's time something is done, I just cannot understand this lack of control in certain members. Total and absolute lack of control. I stand here telling you, you cannot use this. You cannot accuse public servants of hiding.
How many?
Then you want to say that they are withdrawn. You cannot. Your choice of word is not parliamentary. I sit here. I am supposed to adjudicate on that. I so declare. If you cannot accept it, well, you have a choice. I will not permit you to do this to public servants. Okay? Get that very, very clear. This is just...
Madam Speaker, like I say, I rise on a point of order under Section 50...
Standing order?
Standing order, Section 53 of the standing orders of the House. And under those standing orders, Madam Speaker, I want to move a motion and name the member by name. And Madam Speaker, I so move that the Honorable Senator Danny Lugie... The Honorable Member Danny Lugie, member for the Roseau North constituency, Madam Speaker, be made to apologize and, if not so, expelled from the Honorable House for the rest of the city. Suspended from this House for the rest of the city. Do I have a second now?
Seconded, Madam Speaker.
Madam Speaker,
with your permission, the Honourable Minister brought it up, but he hasn't read which section of the standing order. He hasn't brought it to your attention.
Read the whole thing?
Madam Speaker, I will so.
Please read it.
Yes.
And yes.
I rise under Standing Order Section 50.
Standing
Order 53.
Yes.
If a member shows disregard for the authority of the chair and abuses the rules of the House by persistently and willfully obstructing the business of the House, or otherwise, the Speaker or the Chairman shall direct the attention of the members to the incident, mentioning by name the member concerned. Whenever a member has been so named, the Speaker or Chairman, then A, if the offense has been committed in the House, the Speaker shall call upon the Minister to move that Mr. So-and-so be suspended from the service of the House. The Speaker shall put that question on such motion forthwith, no seconder being required, and no amendment, adjournment, or debate being allowed. Madam Speaker, under that section of the standing orders, free section 53A, I move that Honorable Danny Lugie, member for the Roseau North constituency.
There's only one thing going wrong here. I haven't named him yet.
Very well.
Madam okay? Speaker. I am the one that has to name him.
Well, very well.
And the reason why I haven't done so is because I am patiently trying to understand, make the member understand that there is a particular decorum expected of him that I have difficulty in getting him to grasp. He says I insult him. He says that there's witchcraft in the house. I mean, honor member, honestly, I could name you. I'm taking absolute patience, and you're not appreciating it. I could have named you ever since. I could have. I'm just telling you a while ago that you're bordering on doing the same thing again. You take umbrage. I then tell you that you also going to, I even forget not what now, that you were going to do something. I'm just reminding you that there's a rule about tedious and repetitiveness. And you brush me aside. And you think that somebody has something against you. I think, member, I'm asking you, please, to look inwardly. Look inwardly. Nobody has anything against you. It's your behavior people have a problem with. I do. I keep talking to you. How do you expect to come and say public servants are hiding things and get away with it, for goodness sake? And I'm suggesting to you, you say, oh, they left it out or something. And then I suggest to you that the word you may want to use is omitted. You ask me if I want to do your debate for you. I'm clearly recognizing that you have a difficulty finding the right word to you, and I'm assisting you so that you, members don't stand like that. You're not even appreciating that. I'm asking, I know the members feel about it, but since I'm ruling in your favor, I'm asking you to apologize for your outburst. That will be your fifth apology. I've lost count now. And continue, because as far as I can reckon, you have 11 minutes left. And I'm warning you, member, I will name you next time. You've got to select your words carefully and be more parliamentary in your attitude. This is not a meeting that is on the road. This is not anything else but a parliament where members are expected to behave in a certain way, and I certainly will call upon members to do so. And please stop this business of making reference to other members doing this and other members doing that. Look inwardly for a change. Hold yourself to a mirror, please. Your 10 minutes starts now. Your 11 minutes.
Madam Speaker, I apologize. Madam Speaker, you have expended your head D44, $134,000 to facilitate assistance towards 2016 Carnival. Madam Speaker, you know, in that particular Ministry of Community and Constituency Affairs, not one community or constituency held by an opposition parliamentarian benefited from these funds.
I'd like to know what's going on there. You expect us on the opposition side to be fair-minded. You expect us to be courteous. You expect us to behave ourselves in an orderly manner. But when we're seeing that we have a national budget and nothing goes to the opposition, Rosanoff has been penalized. And even in cases where we identify sources of funding for projects, it's being blocked. How you expect me to? You're turning saints into demons. That's what you're doing. That's what you're doing. So take note. Imagine in the Grand Bay constituency, $600,000 was given for playing fields. In Massac, $200,000 was given. In Dublin, $400,000. You have Prime Minister Skerritt and Minister of Finance. He heard the succeeding committee, the Lindo Park Improvement Committee, on the radio. He comes, he flashes a check of $15,000 and calls a press conference. Why do that? $600,000, $400,000, $200,000. In the case where a committee and a community has identified their source of funding, you're blocking the project. As soon as Danny Luger resigns from the committee, it is okay. Without no plan, you know. We had a 10-page plan for the Lindo Park improvements. Jogging tracks, lighting, fencing. You had persons, radio personalities, complaining, oh, there's going to be fence. And even the Prime Minister reported that people were complaining about the use of the park. What a lie. What a lie. There's never that problem of people accessing the park. I am saying it is a lie. What he said is a lie. Yes, what I'm saying, what he said is a lie. And that's the truth.
And you consider a lie is parliamentary language?
And, well, an untruth. An untruth. Is that acceptable to you? An untruth. So, thanks to the New Zealanders and the Australian government, the project is going through. But this beating of the chest by the Prime Minister, it is not his project. It is the people's project, and we as government must never stand in the way of the people's project. Now we have, you know, something that this House must understand, and the people of Dominica and the constituents of Roseau must understand, that Roseau may be the largest contributor to national taxes and the VAT, both by virtue of the population and the number of businesses. So if we contribute into taxes and VAT, we deserve our fair share of the national resources. Under heading D52, we had a public works department for more than 50 years, building our bridges, building our roads, drainage, sidewalks. This administration found a way to destroy public works while the work that public works
should... So hold on a while. Member, you are again imputing improper motive. Don't you understand that you said this administration is destroying public works?
Yes, and let me say why.
No,
that the workers being... The workers who are refused their compensation, even when they are sent home,
member,
and also
the
for
member,
lack of equipment. That's destroying the company. That's destroying the company. So I've explained what I mean.
No, you have not, you know.
Not to your satisfaction?
No,
well,
no, it's not
what,
to, ma- to the,
well,
to
you
the,
can
to
add
the rules.
What you want to add.
To the rules. Oh, I don't know. No. I threw up my hands.
No, Madam Speaker, under D32.
But you have 5 minutes left, eh?
We had the late
4 minutes,
great
actually.
Hugo Chavez of blessed memory, who forced a coffee plant down the throats of this administration, despite the kicking and screaming objection of this ungrateful government. Today, Madam Speaker, millions of pounds of coffee is rotting and secretly and shamelessly being dumped. So too.
Okay. Excuse me. Secretly and shamelessly, that's it, okay? You can take your seat now. That is one over the top. You just said secretly and shamelessly. Well, I don't know if you. You married it to shamelessly. I've had it. Anybody else wish to talk on the thing?
I think my time is up now.
Wow.
Can I appeal to the most senior?
Three members are standing.
Well, I'm standing to speak by the speaker because you asked him to. Now that the speaker.
Well, okay.
That's not true.
I didn't see who stood first, honestly.
I'm senior now. No, I'm not yielding, Madam Speaker.
Pardon?
I'm not yielding, yeah.
Pardon?
No, he asked me to yield, so I said I...
You yielding to him?
No, Madam Speaker, I stand at the judgment, Madam Speaker.
You see, I really didn't see because this member was attracting my attention as usual.
My light is on, Madam Speaker. That asked the member to sit. I tell him yield to seniority. I'm the hospital. Yeah. Thank you, Madam Speaker.
I really didn't see that. You need to put on your mic.
Yeah. Madam Speaker, thank you very much, and thank you, my former schoolmate. Madam Speaker, I need to rise to give my wholehearted and 100% support to the motion before the House. This is the Supplementary Appropriation 2015-2016 Act 2016. And Madam Speaker, may I even go a bit further to say that it will be remiss of me, Madam Speaker, and almost unforgivable or unpardonable, Madam Speaker, if I didn't stand, and I will explain why in a minute, if I didn't stand to give my wholehearted and full-blooded support to this Appropriation Act before us. Madam Speaker, roughly about 1 year ago, Tropical Storm Erica devastated Dominica, and in particular the PD7 constituency. And arguably, Madam Speaker, the PD7 constituency would have been the most affected. 20 or so dead or presumed dead, Madam Speaker. Two communities having to be completely evacuated. And yesterday, I listened wide-eyed, Madam Speaker, and a bit appalled to the member for the Wesley constituency, Madam Speaker, when he stated almost in a sarcastic way that we on the government side were using Erica as an excuse, Madam Speaker. But the fact remains, Tropical Storm Erica did happen on August 27th of 2015. And the fact remains that we lost $1.3 billion, Madam Speaker, almost 90%, over 90% of our GDP. That's a fact, Madam Speaker. So while the opposition member was trying to ridicule and to say that we will thank God for Erica, meaning the government side were really happy that Erica because we could beat everything on Erica. Here are the estimates, Madam Speaker, that had facts and figures before us as to what most of these monies were spent on. That is our recovery efforts as it pertains to Tropical Storm Erica. Madam Speaker, and this is why I said it would be remiss of me if I didn't stand here to give my support to this act, because the PD7 constituency was, as I said, arguably the worst. The hardest hit, Madam Speaker. And as I said, most of the amounts before us would have been spent on recovery efforts, and a great part of it would have been spent in the PD7 constituency. And on this note, Madam Speaker, I really want to thank the Honorable Minister of Finance, Prime Minister, from day one, Madam Speaker, being physically there, and from henceforth, Madam Speaker, ensuring that the PD7 constituents, the residents of PD7 and Dubik, who were most severely affected by Tropical Storm Erica, were well taken care of, Madam Speaker. And just 1 year later, Madam Speaker, 1 year later, the entire community of Dubik has been relocated, Madam Speaker, to a prime property. Prime real estate, Madam Speaker, in the Grand Bay, within the geophysical boundaries of the Grand Bay constituency. And again, I want to thank my colleague, neighbor, friend, medical colleague also, the Honorable Justina Charles, Member of Parliament for Grand Bay, for allowing us, Madam Speaker, to allow us to use her backyard, Madam Speaker, to resettle the unfortunate constituents or residents of Dubik after this unfortunate incident of August of 27th last year. And, Madam Speaker, on this note, I want to go further, Madam Speaker, to say that the residents of Dubik and the vast majority of the residents of Pt. 7, Madam Speaker, has this motion, Madam Speaker, of confidence in our Honourable Prime Minister, Madam Speaker. And in fact, Madam Speaker, since Erica, we would have hosted a number of regional and sub-regional meetings here in Dominica. And one of the side events would be a tour to the areas affected Pt. 7 Dubik. And I recall sometime last year the center area of Grand Bay where the Dubik residents are relocated was one of the areas that we visited. I remember some colleague ministers of mine asking me, what's the arrangement, you know? I mean, how are they going to pay for these houses? And when they were told, Madam Speaker, that these houses are going to be given free of charge, Madam Speaker, free of charge, not the home, not the land, Madam Speaker, the prime land we're talking about, Madam, was going to be sold to them, they couldn't believe their eyes, Madam Speaker. And we have 50 families, Madam Speaker, 50 owners of, as my colleague from the Honorable Minister said, spanking new buildings in the prime area in Grand Bay for the Dubik residents, Madam Speaker. So if this isn't enough, Madam Speaker, just 1 year after Erica, to move a motion of full confidence in the Honorable Prime Minister, Madam Speaker, I don't know what is. And if we go through the figures, Madam Speaker, as it pertains to the resettlement and under the Ministry of Social Services, we'll see the millions of dollars, Madam Speaker, that have been spent, Madam Speaker, either direct assistance to the affected residents or towards the rebuilding in terms of infrastructure, Madam Speaker. Millions of dollars, starting from day one, Madam Speaker, when the families were evacuated and they had to be put in guest houses. And now we have begun the movement from guest houses into rented private accommodations, Madam Speaker. And all of this, Madam Speaker, being met by the government of Dominica. Never before heard in the history of this country, Madam Speaker. I dare say in the region that the government have responded to the people in such a way as this Labour Party administration has responded to the people of the Pt. 7 constituency. And I listened to my friend on the other side, Senator Felix Thomas. And I think he has interest in Pt. 7, Madam Speaker. His daughter, Fong Love, one of the handsome guys in Pt. 7. Pt. 7 is known for very handsome. So his daughter is married to a Pt. 7 resident. She Fong Love in Pt. 7. So I guess he felt that he had a step. But I listened to him appalled. You know, the comments he made. Yeah, the comments he made, Madam Speaker, as it pertains to how the frustration of the Pt. 7 people. And I'm not saying, Madam Speaker, of course there exists a certain amount of frustration. Of course there exists a certain amount of anxiety, Madam Speaker. Imagine you having to leave your home of many years, Madam Speaker. But I want to tell the Honorable Senator that it's through no fault of anybody, Madam Speaker, that El Tropical South America came. And the experts upon experts have advised us that Pt. 7 is, I hope I get it right, uninhabitable, Madam Speaker. It is uninhabitable, so I'm not sure what the good senator is talking about when he says to look at it on a case-by-case basis. The whole area is compromised, Madam Speaker, and the experts have advised us. And in fact, as we speak, we are expecting another team from the UE and a various other institutions, Madam Speaker, 1 year later, to do a review, just to pass back and to let us know whether or not what they still think, if the original, sorry, opinion of Pt. 7 still stands, Madam Speaker. So, Madam Speaker, as a member of Parliament for the Pt. 7 constituency, I stand wholeheartedly behind this appropriation, as I said. A number of my people, my own immediate family, Madam Speaker, my parents, everybody, would have benefited in one way or another through the interventions of the government post-Erica in an effort, Madam Speaker, to make their lives a little easier as we await the ultimate resettlement in the Bellevue-Chopin area. Madam Speaker, I move on to another matter that has been debated quite a bit, the issue of the washrooms. And again, I'm going to pick on my jolly good fellow, Senator Thomas. And again, I listened to him, Madam Speaker, unbelievably saying that he asked some people that they're better than that, do not accept the what he called incomplete washrooms. Madam Speaker, I don't want to really clarify this, Madam Speaker. All of the washrooms that are being built for our needy residents, they're given complete washrooms, Madam Speaker, with water connection in cases where they do not have any original water connection. And Just in case, I'm just saying, perchance, I'm as this in part, si a toucan, there might be one or two people who maybe the water connection would have been delayed, or as he said, that we do the washrooms without the soaker away and the septic tank. That's not true, Madam Speaker. But let's suppose there are one or two incidents, one or two cases where the washroom facility could not be completed. What is wrong in the good septic tank and a cost of a few hundred dollars? One radio for Madam Speaker. The septic tank, the soakaway, and also to pay for the water connection from the Wasco. One phone call to the Senator Ed Regis. To tell the people that do not accept this washroom because you think that they don't have water connection. I think that is very, and I think this goes a lot to show us to the people of Dominica as to how it is that the UWP look at them. Because I don't know about you, but I grew up in the country and I used to visit my grandmother a lot, and it's not a pleasant experience, Madam Speaker, using outside washroom and outside pit latrine. Not a pleasant experience, Madam Speaker. And I'm pretty sure that each and every one of us will agree that a washroom, temporarily even the water, it's okay, Madam Speaker, to have a couple of pills of water, to use it to flush it the washroom while you wait for water connection, much better than having to get up in the middle of the night and go and use a pit latrine, Madam Speaker, with all sort of creatures roaming in and out of the hole. So I really want to say I was really disappointed. I think he was having a really bad day yesterday, Senator Thomas. Usually he gives you no good objective contribution, but I think he was really having a bad day yesterday. You need to talk to your de facto parrot, that's me, to find out what's wrong, sir, so we could talk. So, Madam Speaker, I continue, and I continue from day one. I remember when the Honorable Prime Minister introduced this elimination of pit latrines initiative. The opposition leader and his colleagues, I was going to say cronies, but I don't think that's parliamentary. His colleagues on the other side, Madam Speaker, they lambaste, Madam Speaker. They ridiculed, they scoffed at this initiative, Madam Speaker. Just a few days after, I remember DNO, I think for once they posted something positive. A few days after, DNO posted some article from United Nations where United Nations declared war on pit latrines, Madam Speaker, recognizing, Madam Speaker, the millions and maybe even billions of residents around the world where sanitation, Madam Speaker, is an issue. SDG 6, clean water and sanitation. And we are well on the way, Madam Speaker, to achieving this sustainable development goal. Sanitation, the Prime Minister would have made a commitment that by the end of 2017, we do not want to have a pit latrine here anywhere in Dominica, Madam Speaker. In terms of clean water, I'm sure the Honorable Acting Minister for Water Resources Management will speak to it. Over 99% adequate to access to potable water. And I heard one of the other members also lamenting the fact that are we building better in terms of climate resilient storage. The opposition members, Madam Speaker, they need to do their research and do their homework before they come to talk rubbish in this Honorable House, Madam Speaker. Okay, because under the DVRP program, Madam Speaker, which is a climate resilient program funded by the World Bank, we have 8 or 9 water storage tanks, Madam Speaker, being built along the West Coast, and the Senator Regis can allude to that. Climate resilient to build the water storage tanks bigger and better, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, the much talked about National Employment Program, and the Honorable Minister of Trade, I see he left momentarily. I want to thank him, Madam Speaker. Again, as a Member of Parliament for Petit Servan, just a few weeks ago, I would have been the beneficiary of over 100 new interns, Madam Speaker, on the National Employment Program. And I want to put to rest, Madam Speaker, once and for all, the myth and the misconception and also the poisoning of the Dominican public mind by the members of the opposition as it pertains to the National Employment Program. In fact, Madam Speaker, just coming from the PMH a few moments ago to deal with the 148 situation, I was pleased, Madam Speaker, to meet in the hallways of the PMH, Madam Speaker, a number of young people, NDP interns, now being trained at the Princess Margaret Hospital. And unlike what the opposition is saying, Madam Speaker, it's not a short-term employment and they get dumped afterwards. Because we would know that we are weighing costs into construction of our new national hospital. So this is why I have admonished these new interns that they should do well to get training seriously. So when this new hospital comes on stream, and we are definitely going to be needing new staff, much more staff. They would already be trained, Madam Speaker, and fit right into the established employment system, Madam Speaker. So this notion of it's a short-term employment and they're going to be kicked out of the street and students with A-levels or whatever, cleaning streets, Madam Speaker, this is a myth, okay, need to be dispelled, okay, being propagated by the members of the opposition. In the community, Madam Speaker, and I think you need to, with all due respect, Madam Speaker, you might need to speak to the Honorable Minister for Technology so we can have screens, Madam Speaker, so we can project what is happening in our constituency during Parliament. Because obviously, Madam Speaker, the members of the opposition, they sit wherever they sit, I don't know where they go or what they do, and they take no interest in what is going on around the island. Because right now, I could show you, Madam Speaker, the fantastic work being done by my NEP teams in the 57 constituency, the Bagatelle Fusilier, beautification, Madam Speaker, keeping the area clean. This would be, it would make a lot of sense, Madam Speaker. I mean, you could shift all you want to project it, Madam Speaker, so they could see where the thousands of dollars that's being spent, how it's being spent, Madam Speaker, and it's being put to good use. To look at the various projects in the constituency. And, but I'll not repeat what the member said. So, Madam Speaker, maybe something that you can consider so we can sit here and maybe project so they can see for themselves what exactly is being done, and they could take a page from our book to see how they can also copy some of these things in their constituency. So, the care of the elderly, Madam Speaker, you've heard a number of us lament the fact that a number of the elderly, Madam Speaker, the senior citizens, people who would have made the contributions before, people who would have blazed the trail before us, Madam Speaker, how sometimes they get abandoned by their family. And I'm glad that this care of the elderly facet of the National Employment Program exists, Madam Speaker. So the people before us, the people who came before us and made their contribution, Madam Speaker, they are well taken care of. The public support program, Madam Speaker, and I want to spend a few minutes on that because I'm sure the Honorable Minister of Finance and maybe the other members of Parliament will allude or attest to the fact that a lot of this money, Madam Speaker, is spent on health, emergency health services that are not available here on island, Madam Speaker. And of course, we would have heard the Minister of Finance commit $5 million into a national health insurance, a pilot national health insurance, Madam Speaker. And we at the Ministry of Health, we really welcome and applaud this initiative, Madam Speaker, and we look forward to its implementation. Because a lot of times, Madam Speaker, these are people, poor people who could not afford the conventional health insurance. But they find themselves in a situation, Madam Speaker, what do we do as a government? Do we tell them, well, okay, sorry, we cannot help? So if you look, Madam Speaker, and I'm pretty sure that most of the invoices submitted in terms of the amount spent under the public support program, I'm pretty sure that more than half of these invoices will be related to emergency health services, especially in our neighboring islands where the service is not available here in Dominica. Madam Speaker, at the constituency level, in spite of Tropical Storm Erica, and I'm sure again, if you look at the number of the amounts spent, Madam Speaker, into various community projects, washroom projects, you will agree, Madam Speaker, that even after Tropical Storm Erica, the government could have said, listen, a lot of these social programs, these community-based projects, these things have to go on the whole, Madam Speaker. No, we didn't say that, Madam Speaker. And I think this speaks volume to the fact that we are able to continue our social programs, our community-based projects, in spite of the damage caused by Tropical Storm Erica, Madam Speaker. In the Bellevue-Chope area, we spent almost $200,000 on a community road, two tranches of money post-Erica, Madam Speaker. And this is commendable, Madam Speaker. This is commendable because, as I said, we could easily have said, okay, Erica's come, we'll have to wait because we have bigger national priorities, Madam Speaker. But we continue to do our community work. Pichlen, Madam Speaker, those of you who have not visited Pichlen, you need to, Madam Speaker, to see what a world-class basketball court looks like, Madam Speaker, in the community of Pichlen. The member for Maho, sorry, the Minister of National Security, not agree to me, with me, sorry. But you need to visit Pichlen, Madam Speaker, to see what a world-class basketball court is, Madam Speaker. All of this done and developed post-Erica, Madam Speaker, because this government has understood that in spite of the tremendous national responsibility, Madam Speaker, we still have to continue to do the work at the grassroots level to ensure that our people continue to have proper facilities, proper housing, etc. Madam Speaker, the Ministry of Health, we saw a few million dollars being dispensed as it pertains to, $500,000 as it pertains to fighting Zika. Madam Speaker, and I want to also spend a few minutes on this new and emerging threat, the Zika virus. And while the government continues, Madam Speaker, to do all that it can in terms of assisting in fighting the Zika virus, I want to take this opportunity, Madam Speaker, in this Honorable House to speak to the citizens of the country, Madam Speaker, that they too have a civic responsibility in keeping the environment clean. You would recall, Madam Speaker, that sometime last year, it was, Honorable Stevenson, that we had a very successful week cleanup campaign where we spent hundreds of thousands of dollars, Madam Speaker, getting rid of white goods and other receptacles that could otherwise be harboring vectors such as mosquitoes, rodents, etc. But, Madam Speaker, all of this is going to amount to naught if the citizens do not continue the fight on a daily basis, keeping the environment clean, the immediate surroundings, their block, their community, and the country by extension. So we will continue to invest money, Madam Speaker. As you can see, we spent close to, over $800,000, Madam Speaker, as it pertains to fighting Zika, National Pest and Termite Control, as it pertains to combating the Zika virus. But all of these, I said, will amount to nothing if the citizens do not take proper care of the environment. Fogging, I'm sure a lot of you in the community would have seen the National Pest Control and Environmental Health together do pass it around with the handheld fogging machines to ensure, as I said, that we get rid of the adult mosquitoes. And I'm sure my level-headed deputy, the Parliamentary Secretary, the Minister of Health, who is an environmental health expert in his own right, I'm sure we'll speak a bit more to that. We also paid quite a sum of money, Madam Speaker, to an oncologist, over $200,000, Madam Speaker, because we recognize that, and we would, of course, have heard in recent years the issue of CNCDs, Madam Speaker, under which cancer falls, and the tremendous toll, Madam Speaker, this is taking on our citizens and also on our budget, fighting CNCDs. And we would have seen in recent years, Madam Speaker, an increasing number of cancer patients on the island. Unfortunately, Madam Speaker, we would have had to seek services of our Cuban friends. And in this case, Madam Speaker, we sought the services of a trained and experienced oncologist to beef up, Madam Speaker, our fight against cancer here in Dominica. A lot of money, Madam Speaker, but we think that when you look at what cancer is doing, Madam Speaker, to our society, we think that it's worth every penny of it. I'm sure, of course, the question is going to ask, what is Plan B? Just to let you know that we have an oncologist who should soon finish in a training and should be back on island for full-time services. Pharmaceuticals, Madam Speaker, $900,000, Madam Speaker. And we just concluded the OECS PPS, Pool Procurement Services meeting, together with the Council of Health Ministers here in Dominica sometime last week, Madam Speaker. And I'm pleased to announce, Madam Speaker, you would have heard, I'm sure, a lot of the ministers from the OECS sub-region speak to delinquency in payments to the OECS PPS, Madam Speaker. And I'm pleased to announce, Madam Speaker, that Dominica is not one of them, Madam Speaker. We're not one of them, Madam Speaker, because we recognize the importance of having these much-needed pharmaceuticals and medical supplies available to our patients, especially our patients who are being treated at the primary care level as it pertains to chronic diseases such as high blood pressure, diabetes. They get this medication, Madam Speaker, free of charge. So I also need the public to be aware of that, Madam Speaker, that while they get the drugs, we prefer to use pharmaceuticals free of charge, Madam Speaker, it's costing the state quite a bit of money to procure them. So they need to ensure that when the doctor prescribes XYZ for you, Madam Speaker, that you take it as prescribed. Do not pile it at your home because all of these things cost money. $1 million, Madam Speaker, $900,000 we just expended to meet outstanding payments to the PPS. So in spite of our challenges, Madam Speaker, I'm sure the OECS PPS would have understood if we said that, hey, we just came from tropical South America, if you could give us a little break, a little grace period in terms of meeting our payments. No, Madam Speaker, we understand the importance of having these supplies available to our patients. We made sure that we made the necessary payments. We spoke about infrastructure, Madam Speaker, at the constituency level. Millions of dollars spent, Madam Speaker, and the important thing, Madam Speaker, to our small contractors, Madam Speaker, small contractors, millions of dollars being spent in terms of river dredging in the Pichne, Bagatelle, Fonsege, and Geneva area. We also spend millions of dollars, Madam Speaker, in smaller interventions in terms of the major road work between Lubie and the Bagatelle community. And we're still going to spend more, Madam Speaker. In the Pichne area, the Geneva Bridge, millions of dollars, and $1.something million project, having this box culvert bridge bill, Madam Speaker, prior to the Geneva playing field. And I see the almost completed in the next few weeks. I'm pretty sure that this bridge will be used. Road works between Pichne, Madam Speaker, in the Maranatha Square area. So when you hear the opposition come and try to make it appear that this whole issue of supplementary appropriation, Madam Speaker, is this eerie and is this really suspicious thing, Madam Speaker, Here are the figures, Madam Speaker, on where these amounts of money were spent. And I think what the opposition should be doing, Madam Speaker, is saying, thank God that we had the monies available to be able to do this intervention, Madam Speaker. And they should be asking us, Madam Speaker, they should be asking us on the government side, how do you guys do it? They should be calling Prime Minister and telling him, Madam Speaker, the leader of the opposition should be asking the Prime Minister, Bossman, come tell me, just in case we win an election sometime in the next 50 years, Madam Speaker, tell me how you do it so I'll be able to perform as well as you and your team is performing. This is what they should be saying, Madam Speaker, instead of trying to cry down, Madam Speaker, a supplementary appropriation, because it's nothing new, Madam Speaker. It happens all the time. We as adults, working adults, Madam Speaker, we try to build up our savings. Okay, of course, assuming that everything goes well. Of course, if everything goes well, then we will stick to a budget that we plan on a monthly basis. Madam Speaker, but things happen. Children get sick. Okay, your vehicle gets into an accident or your vehicle breaks down, house repairs, whatever the case may be, and you now have to go back to your savings. So you have to say, thank God, to be able to use to meet these unexpected expenses that we're meeting now. And this is what the opposition should be doing, saying, guys, you guys are doing a great job, because were you guys not doing a great job, all of these things, Madam Speaker, would be outstanding. In other words, the road between Bagatelle and Roseau in Pichel area would still be all broken down. Motorists would be complaining. We would not have the PD7 constituents, Senator Thomas. They would be all around, roaming all around the place, being left to fend for themselves, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, you could go through them one by one. All of these interventions, they'll be left undone. And then they would be saying, but what are you guys doing? So instead of commending the government and saying, well done, guys, well done. We have money, you have your donors, quite a bit being given by donors. The CBI program is available. See, thank God that you guys are doing such a wonderful job in managing the economy, that you had these monies. They're available to do these interventions instead of coming to the House. And this is why, Madam Speaker, the motion of yesterday, I did not want to, it has been gone and buried even before it was born, Madam Speaker. It was like a premature abortion, Madam Speaker, as we say in our medicine, where the fetus dies even before it comes out into the world. So that is what happened in the motion yesterday. And you could see why it happened. None of them, Madam Speaker, stood up to support their leader, even after he was given his full time. Even after he has given his full time to put forward his motion as to why he's bringing forward his motion of no confidence in our Prime Minister. They could have stood up afterwards after his time expired to help him, but they realized themselves. I saw the member for Roseau sitting well amused, Madam Speaker, with a little smoke on his face as always, laughing, wondering what's going on. You know? My good friend Joseph Isaac and Danny Logo said the member for Roseau said he came well prepared. You came well prepared. Well, stand up to defend. Stand up to assist your leader of the opposition in his motion. So this is why, Madam Speaker, I said this was a premature abortion, Madam Speaker. The fetus died at about maybe 5 weeks, Madam Speaker, yes. So, Madam Speaker, with this, miss, if I have anything left noted to speak about, Madam Speaker, the Ministry of Health, I spoke about the intervention at the Ministry of Health level. Madam Speaker, we continue to benefit, and I hope it looks like the written response asked for by the member of for Mary God Reed, the new hospital, was to his satisfaction. I see he didn't say anything about his blood boiling over this time around. So I'm guessing that the response given to him, Madam Speaker, the written response, met his approval this time around. So, Madam Speaker, as I said, as Member of Parliament for PD7 and Minister of Health, I 100% from my support, Madam Speaker, behind this supplementary appropriation. And I again want to restate, Madam Speaker, reiterate, or I'm trying to get a better word, Madam Speaker, our confidence in the leadership of the Honourable Prime Minister of this country, and will continue to stand 100% behind him. Thank you very much.
Before you begin, I want to remind you of your accusations to the chair at the last time we were here. Please.
I can't even remember.
You scurried away before I could admonish you. I'm not even going to do so now. I'm just calling on your memory to serve you well this time around.
Madam Speaker, I always think positive, so I cannot really remember.
Pardon?
The details. I can't remember the details. So, anyway, Madam Speaker, thank you. Madam Speaker, I rise to make my contribution on the supplementary appropriation 2015-2016. Madam Speaker, before I start, I would like to congratulate the graduates of the Dominica State College, which I had the opportunity to attend yesterday. I also want to wish the members on both sides a happy independence, and yourself, Madam Speaker, blessed and happy independence. Madam Speaker, I sat and listened for over 24 hours now to the deliberation on both sides. Madam Speaker, it was with shock, surprise, and disappointment that I listened to the other side. But before I go into further discussion on the matter, I would like to just highlight the fact that yesterday, the Honorable Minister of Sports and Constituency Empowerment, Honorable Charles, alluded to the fact that in a deliberation that she was focusing on the issue of leadership and fiscal management. Also, the Minister of Education, the Honorable Peter Sejean, again said that the opposition side need to be involved in consultation and discussion. The Minister for Technology spoke about the performance of the ICT sector, and he spoke about other national issues. This morning, or just a while ago, I listened attentively to the Minister of Health and Environment. I think that presentation was an exception, although not with passion, but intellectually sound. You see where he actually looked at the numbers and actually went through it and discussed it. But Madam Speaker, the matter of the supplementary appropriation is not a new matter, as he said. It is really a tool to guide the budget process. But when we evaluate it, based on all the deliberations so far, the delivery by the other members, I see no discussion on one, what is a measure of good performance? When they're speaking about their different departments, but they are not telling us why do they say they had good performance. And when they come to us in this honorable house for approval, it is like a company is being run and you have a chief executive officer who is the prime minister and also the chief financial officer. And you have set a budget and you are now coming back to the board with all your department heads or the leaders. And they are saying that we set a budget, but we overspent. But the interesting fact is, we overspent, they are telling us, but that is in 2015-2016. We are now in 2016-2017. So this is really an academic exercise. But since we are here to debate and represent the people of our different constituencies, we will do that. But the people, Madam Speaker, through you, the people need to understand that regardless of what we say here today, that we are talking about water under the bridge. It has passed. So we need to evaluate the past performance. First of all, when we evaluate it, we see that the supplementary appropriation is about 17% of the actual budget. And Madam Speaker, if it is 17% above the budget, then we'd say either you have poor planning process or you deliberately plan bad. Now, hold on. I'm going to talk about Tropical Storm Erica. If you remove Tropical Storm Erica numbers, you will see that it is still above 10% variance. Now, anywhere in the world, if you're managing something and you consistently come year after year with high variances, it would show that you are either abusing the process, since it's a Westminster system, and when you come to the House, the appropriation has already passed. A year passed. So now we are now in October debating something that ended in July. And it started since last year. So it's really water under the bridge. So, as I said, you need to tell us what you mean by good measure. You need to tell us what are the indicators that you are saying that you want us to approve something that have already passed. And therefore, since it has already passed, I will go line by line, but through you, Madam Speaker, informing the public that the opposition cannot do anything to change the numbers now, because it has already passed. And in fact, the government side, as I said, as the leaders of each ministry, they are responsible for running this country. And just the opposition is playing a role in parliament to point out things and to give recommendations. But if it has already passed, then what can we do if it has already passed? So we'll still talk about the future. Madam Speaker, I've been fortunate or privileged to have experience working in different areas. I worked as a public officer. I worked as a teacher, a farmer, a business person, a technocrat. So I understand the plight of the different players. Madam Speaker, so what I expected from the delivery so far was one, how are we in the different ministries, for example, in agriculture? We had an objective of setting, let's say, dashing production from X tons to Y tons, and we achieve it, or we did not achieve it, so we want some more money. Then we say, okay, although it passed, we are in support of it. Now, we might debate on whether you did it effectively or not, but what are your indicators? Most of the opponents, my most worthy opponents, have come, and every time to get a clap, they just say the Prime Minister is the best thing in the world. But nothing about their ministry and what their objectives were. And did they meet the objective as leaders of a ministry or department? So, Madam Speaker, after listening to them, I wasn't feeling hopeful. Because again, for example, in the Ministry of Health or the Ministry of Trade, I didn't hear anything about, okay, we were actually spending X amount in, let's say, in expenses, in electricity, and we did certain things to reduce the cost. And therefore, we are asking now, as Dr. Daru said, Honorable Dr. Daru, my esteemed colleague, said, Minister, no problem, I'll give you all your colleagues. Where have you saved? What have you done? Well, again, they like to say that we don't give or recognize when something is done well. I listened to the Honorable Minister of Kalinago Affairs, and I listened attentively, and I liked when you spoke about the solar energy initiative. So again, in that case, although what I expected to hear was, we had an objective of putting X amount of solar panels amounting to whatever wattage, and now we achieved 25%. Norma, you had an opportunity to speak, my esteemed colleague. So, Madam Speaker, let us go through some of the areas. As I said, it is water under the bridge. It has passed, but we will still do what we have to do as parliamentarians. Madam Speaker, under D29, where we deal with purchase of machinery for the multipurpose park houses, again, we would like to thank the CARICOM Development Fund for contributing to the Commonwealth of Dominica. 1.2 million. Madam Speaker, talking about budgeting process and the process of development. And that's why I said I was really disappointed. Because it is over 6, going on 8 years between that time there, from conception to implementation. And only now we are saying that we have implemented that just last year. And everything is still not in place, Madam Speaker. So again, it is showing a lack of effective planning, because we don't have key measures and indicators of where we're trying to achieve certain milestones. No. The leader is the ministry head and the prime minister, minister of finance. That's where the resources is. So, Madam Speaker, again, in respect to that facility, we need to look at the holistic approach. So every time we come piecemeal, we're not looking at the entire value chain and try to achieve one objective or two and complete it, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, when we look at D29, local training, NEP, $4.8 million. And again, and that's why I keep saying, I see that the Prime Minister made an attempt to align some of his ministries with the effective human resource. So, for example, a medical doctor is responsible for Ministry of Health, which is good, commendable, but some people must keep to what they know. You cannot, and I will reiterate it again, we on the opposition side, we are in support of a national internship program. Nothing wrong with that. But since it is water under the bridge, we need to, and through you, Madam Speaker, talking to the public, we need to understand that it is not a national employment program. It is a transitional program holding until the private sector can absorb the people. The Honorable Minister of Health and Environment, Dr. Daru, said it. In fact, the Minister of Trade, Honorable Ian Douglas, said it is a social program. He did not say it's an economic program. So I accept that, no problem. But say what it is. So again, if we are doing effective planning, you will ensure that not just a national internship program. What you'll do is you'll give support to a private sector, for example, not, and I'll reach on the abattoir. You'll give up complete budget, proper capitalization with permanent staff. That is what we talk about development, not a transitional program. Madam Speaker, I would again, as a member for Roseau, Parliament for Roseau, I want to also say that the allocation of $500,000 for the music professionals was a good idea again. But see what has happened? Only 10% of it was actually spent from the budgeted allocation. So the question is, what have we done to ensure that there is drawdown? What were the pitfalls? What were the constraints? Why they did not draw down? What are we doing in the ministry responsible for that area to ensure that there is better drawdown? So again, I would like to thank the Prime Minister for doing that on behalf of the music professionals. But again, as I said, we need to identify the constraints. And in your absence, Honorable Prime Minister, I was saying that we needed to show what are the indicators, how are we measuring success? And not your colleagues just come in and say, you are the best Prime Minister. That is what they think, but they need to support it. So, yeah. Dr. Daru like that, Dr. Daru like that. So, Madam Speaker, we will support, as I said, is water under the bridge. We can't change the numbers now. It was already spent. So, and I said in your absence, is either a deliberate attempt to abuse the process or a deliberate attempt to hold back some of the monies in terms of spending to do it when you need to do it in certain areas. Because a proper process would be to come every 6 months. Can I be planning when you go in 17% variance above budget? See, they cannot understand that. That's why maybe the Prime Minister, Honorable Prime Minister, need to organize a workshop for some of the colleagues on the other side. Madam Speaker, when I move to D45, financial support for SME post-tropical storm Erica. Madam Speaker, yes, again, we welcome it, support to SMEs, but I will talk about that. I just pointing it out for now. So let us move to D31 under Office of the Prime Minister, specific to facilitate short-term financing for HHV Whitchurch in amount of 500,000. Madam Speaker, I listen to both sides. Madam Speaker, I want to take an independent view there. Because as I said in your absence of my background, Madam Speaker, first of all, we lack a transparent policy. What is the policy? What is the objective? We need to have a specific objective of why are we helping? What are the conditions and expectations of when we give that loan? And the question is the government now a bank? I'm not saying it should not help, but I'm saying these are questions as a collective cabinet you should have asked yourself if you have not done it already. But since you did not bring it to parliament, I'll assume that you have not given that thought process. Because there is no board or no bank in Dominica where, for example, a manager can just give a significant amount of loan without approval somewhere. But I would say, since it's cabinet that approved, so cabinet has the collective responsibility. So the question is, Madam Speaker, why not give a guarantee instead? So we, and as I said, the opposition is not the operating arm of government. It is the cabinet who has the responsibility to implement, and will give recommendations, will advocate. So, Madam Speaker, the Dominica, the DAPEX is struggling. DBS struggling, Public Works struggling, Dominica Essential Oil, I don't know why it's the latest on it. I was aware that they were trying to get some new location. No, you'll have your turn. I'm just advising. So, Madam Speaker, again, if we, and we're talking about leadership, remember what the Honorable Minister of Sports said. No, you can respond, no problem. Yeah.
He's allowed me to say a few things here. I mean, he would know that is. But okay, no, he just give me some time of his time.
No problem. Oh, of my time? No, not of my time. So, yeah. Thank you. No, hold on. I'm getting to that. So, Madam Speaker, why not bring a business bailout bill? So, hold on, let me make my point, Madam Speaker. So if it is dangerous, that means under the office of the Prime Minister, one man decides that one company gets $500,000. So, well, obviously, the one man would be the Minister of Finance, Prime Minister. He'd come convince his colleagues, and they say, okay, cool, because, Madam Speaker, all of them saying it's the best thing. Yeah. So that means he already have leverage over cabinet. He has leverage over cabinet. Because when the different leaders of the ministries supposed to come and say what they have done for the ministry, for them to get a little clap, they just have to say, the prime minister, thank God, and blah, 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 and everybody clapping. But no, I'm just telling you what you are doing. And I'm asking you to, from no one, come and speak about your ministry. Come and show leadership. The people of Dominica, through the prime minister, put the confidence in you to be ministers of government. You have a responsibility to show that what your objectives were.
You have 5 minutes left.
Okay, Madam Speaker. So, Madam Speaker, I'm saying now to my esteemed colleagues on that side, let us have a transparent, holistic approach, a proper policy, so that when we know, any private company can know how they could qualify to get a bailout. And it will not look personal. That's all I'm saying. I'm not saying that something is wrong in terms of the psyche, but I'm saying in terms of the financial process, something is wrong with that. But that is for, as one of the colleagues on the other side said, that is for us to search our conscience. Madam Speaker, on the National Abattoir, again, we come here in this honorable house. There was no long discussion on, well, we had a budget of X amount and we could not achieve it because that happened and this happened and proper explanation. And our objective was to open by that time, but we could not open because of that. So we are asking for further 80,000 because we kind of miscalculate some of the finances required in some area. We spend it there, so now we need a little bridge financing for paying salaries. Because when you come to this honorable house for a little $80,000, a state coming for a little $80,000, for a large investment like that, it's showing that the project was undercapitalized or poor planning. That's all it's showing. And I'm not saying it's the prime minister's fault straight off, but he has the ultimate responsibility. But it's showing that the Minister of Agriculture is slipping on him, Madam Speaker. He's slipping. You'll give me the 5 more minutes, man? All right. So, yeah. Madam Speaker, I just have 2 more sections. So, Madam Speaker, under D35, Ministry of Social Services, Family and Gender Affairs, specific to the line item saying operating and maintenance services, and more specifically says construction of washrooms in St. Joseph constituency. Madam Speaker, anywhere we are trying to alleviate a social problem, we will support it on the other side, bearing in mind that we don't have unlimited amount of resources. But Madam Speaker, as the PAL rep for Roseau, I must ask again, what has happened to the Bafford basketball court? When we started, I actually put personal money in it, and then it was graded, and then a little flimsy and back court was placed there because of political sabotage, because election was coming up. So guys should try a fast thing, Madam Speaker. And then now, the little backboard there now is broken down now, because it is not a strong, sturdy facility. Madam Speaker, we also spoke about and make representation and spoke about a proper washroom facility for that same area, the basketball court. Nothing was done. We are requesting now, since it's water under the bridge, we are moving forward. We are requesting, placing it on the record now, that we are requesting support for the Bafford basketball court, the washroom facilities there. We are placing it on the record. Madam Speaker, sometimes you have to wonder if the other members on that side are really seeing what is happening. We are building a bridge on the, I'll call it more or less the West Coast Bridge. Yeah. But the EC Low Black Bridge, all the railings are rotten in. Big holes in the bridge. Well, some people, when they become prime minister, they're not walking around again. Minister of Communication and Works not walking around, so they don't know about that. But I'm pointing it out on the record again. So they cannot say we did not make the request. Moving forward again, we are asking that you need to consider the repair of what you have first before you go into big capital projects. Although we welcome the capital project in Roseau. Madam Speaker, the Paradise Valley people, the direct support, they were impacted by Tropical Storm Erica. So we are again asking the collective group, the cabinet, led by the Honorable Prime Minister, to consider, one, the wall that we have been discussing, and also to help alleviate their challenges through some short-term financing there. Madam Speaker, also, Tropical Storm Erica impacted the people, the vendors close to KFC. I don't know if it was a strategy and saying, praise God, that had happened to eliminate them. But I'm asking on the record again that the members of cabinet, together with your leader, consider helping them, the vendors there. Madam Speaker, the much talked about practice field where at the time Senator Alvin Bernard cut the grass over 5 times to put a practice field. Now the Chinese occupy there. I had a short discussion with the Prime Minister, but for confidentiality, I'll leave that alone. But in essence, Madam Speaker, I was disappointed that the Chinese were given the place there to occupy a place where traditionally the Prime Minister, the many, Dr. Daru, and several of them here went to the Dominica Grammar School.
Just a moment. The rules require you to call every member by their portfolio.
Just two members I wanted to call. Two members.
Well, this is a portfolio have to use.
Okay, the Honorable Prime Minister and Minister of Finance.
Right.
Honorable. Say doctor, no, because I'm not sure if to say the doctor.
Yes.
Remember, I'm not a PhD, so I'm not sure. Okay, doctor. Scary. And Dr. Daru. Yes, Minister of Health and Environment. Madam Speaker, they went to grammar. Yes.
You can sit down. Madam Speaker, I move that the member for Roseau Central be given an additional 5 minutes. To complete his contribution to the supplementary appropriation.
Seconded. Make sure your bus is ready.
Yes.
He can't give you 5 minutes
yes.
on your bus today. Shame on you.
Just one moment. There seems to be a conditional seconded there by the member for Roseau North. Can I go ahead and put it to the floor? It has been moved and seconded that the member be given a further 5 minutes to complete his contribution. Those in favor? Those against? The ayes have it.
Yes, Madam Speaker. I remember the days when the Prime Minister was at the Dominica Grammar School, and I would ask him to remember the pride we had in grammar school as his. At the time, I was a teacher at grammar school when he was there. And I went to grammar school, same class, with the Honorable Minister of Health and Environment for 5 years and all 6 form. So we should have some pride because we were in technical wing and all those places. So I'm asking again, I don't know what the plan is because now they put some serious infrastructure in that same location. However, as usual, I always have recommendations. So I'm now asking this Honorable Cabinet members to gather with the Prime Minister to discuss the area where they call the forecourt at the Windsor Park Stadium. Let us look at it again, where we can have, even if it's a temporary, because if we cannot afford to do the indoor, do a temporary measure where we have a multi-purpose netball, volleyball, basketball court. We need that. Madam Speaker, last night I was watching the football of the 1980s. Where Dominica was actually winning in those days. But now, because of the lack of facilities in Roseau Central, you have to understand that. If you are the center of sports for many years, and then that is damaged, obviously it will impact your national performance. Because that's where your highest concentration of population is. You understand? So I'm asking, you don't understand. You see, respectfully, respectfully, members on the other side, esteemed colleagues, that is where the problem is. When you have a minister of sports who maybe never really play competitive sports, she doesn't understand that you need to do a lot of practice and you need to have a lot of tournaments. So when you have a lot of tournaments, you are always in shape and then you'll perform better. So again, let's not miss the point. I'm asking. I'm asking. Remember, Honorable Prime Minister, you were not there again. I don't know what happened. I said again, on that side, on the Labour Party administration side, you have the responsibility to run the country. You have the control of all the resources, the financial resources of the state. We don't have the resources. Under the Westminster system, you have the responsibility. And I'm looking forward to the next presentation on your side, when the members there can come and talk about their ministry and not call the Prime Minister name to get a little clap. Stand on your own. Be a man. Be a woman. Now, on D46, planning, economic development and investment. Again, Madam Speaker, the line area where it speaks about the national land use policy, management and technical and administrative support in respect of the national physical development plan. I want to commend the government on that again. That is a good approach, good initiative. It is falling straight in line with my argument that we need to have proper planning and policy systems in place together with the budget process. So again, I would like to commend the leadership of whichever ministry, whoever the minister who is leading it there. I want to commend that effort because that is a good approach. I would also want to say that your colleagues on the other side and our members on that side, we want to tell you that we would like you to understand that you need to have the financial and human resource.
Your time is up.
Yes, to ensure that it is effective. Madam Speaker, thank you. And I'd like to tell you a special happy independence to the people of Roseau Central. Thank you, Madam Speaker. No, I noted because it was water under the bridge.
You're not supporting what's under the bridge, buddy. I got it. Yes, sir.
Well, if words could do things, boy, well. Madam Speaker, I move that the House be suspended until 3 p.m. this afternoon.
Seconded, Madam Speaker.
It has been moved and seconded that this Honorable House be suspended until 3 p.m. this afternoon. Those in favor?
Aye.
Those against? The ayes have it. This Honorable House stands suspended until 3 p.m. this afternoon.